This is RBN, the Republic Broadcasting Network.
Hello, friends. Don't you love that music? It is Tuesday, May 10th. This is Spingola Speaks, and this is Deanna Spingola. Authorities released Ernst Zundel from the Mannheim prison on March 1st, 2010, after more than 7 years of incarceration in three countries. I want to share a few paragraphs from the introduction of a book compiled by Barbara Kulaska, the editor and an attorney living in Canada. Zundel was being portrayed in the media as a man of hatred, but the man I saw in the courtroom was calm and always gracious to everyone he dealt with. When he testified, he did not repudiate his belief in Germans or Germany or Adolf Hitler. He expressed clearly his admiration for their accomplishments and his disbelief that they had committed what is known as the Holocaust. Perhaps I'd never really known what it meant to be courageous before that trial, but I knew what it meant after I watched Ernst Zundel testify to his true beliefs, notwithstanding his knowledge that the voicing of those beliefs would almost certainly seal his conviction. And every day as I watched defense attorney Douglas Christie, his legal assistant Kelty Zubro, and the various defense witnesses making their way through crowds of hostile Jews, some of whom spat on them, as I watched them being savaged by the hysterical media, as I experienced the lynch mob atmosphere of that trial, day after day, I learned again and again what real courage was and what real dedication to the principles of a free society meant. It affected me profoundly. When the second Zundel trial began in 1988, it was no accident that I also had become a part of the defense team. While Jewish organizations and the mass media expressed satisfaction that Zundel had been convicted, many ordinary people in Canada were shocked at the implications of the trial for freedom of speech and thought. In a letter to the Toronto Sun, Linda Mortel of Toronto wrote, and I quote, "Why are we Canadians allowing a certain pressure group to act as censors for us? And worse, to have a member of society brought to trial, probably jailed and or deported for saying something we will not even be allowed to read. The more I think about the implications of this trial, the more angry and frightened I become. I am one Canadian who does not want Sabina Citron, Alan Sheffman, or Julian Scher to decide what I will read or what I will call the truth," unquote. Well, today I have a wonderful guest. He is Dr. Tomislav Sunik. He is the author of Homo Americanus, Child of the Postmodern Age. And that was written in 2007. He is the former professor of political science in the U.S. He is the director and the cultural counselor of the American Third Position. His website is tomsunik.info. Now, that book that I read those paragraphs from is called Did 6 Million Really Die? A Report of the Evidence in the Canadian False News Trial of Ernst Zundel, 1988. It is available at Amazon for $130 new or used for $120 or at zundelsite.com for $55. Big difference. We were going to talk about the trial and also free speech issues, and that is certainly at risk. Freedom of speech is at risk in every country, basically. Mm-hmm. But you know probably more about Germany. You wanted to sure. talk about the German criminal code and
all
and,
right.
Okay.
Whatever your listeners feel comfortable with, it's fine with me. Let me, if you allow me, I'd just like to give a broader picture as far as Ernst Zundel is concerned. Now, we can single out a few elements that are worth talking about. Like, we can certainly use Mr. Zundel as a, so to speak, a case study for our better understanding of the German judiciary, or for that matter, for the better understanding of the Western judiciary. And then the second point also, I guess, worth mentioning is that Ernst Zundel symbolizes the plight of the German people, specifically the German civilians who were thrown out, and many of them were killed, of course, after the Second World War, from Eastern Europe. We're talking about 10 to 15 million people who were expelled from their ancient homelands. And then the third issue, of course, is the trickiest one, and that one involves actually Zindel himself and the charges that actually landed him into a jail. By and large, this is something that needs to be, we need to raise the issue of this, why not? We can call it the fallacy of the judiciary in the United States, or in Germany, or for that matter, the free speech. What does that mean? How does that matter in higher education in the United States of America? And I indeed think he probably has a sad privilege that Ernst Zindel, he actually tackled some of those issues. But so let me just first start with some opening remarks, if I may.
Sure, please.
Okay, I guess your listeners can make themselves a value judgment as to what extent the West, and especially the Western judiciary, for that matter, Canadian judiciary, American judiciary, is still free, and to what extent this judiciary is subject to different pressure groups and different views and different pesterings, if I can put it that way, by different lobbies. Ernest Zindel does remind me in a much lesser degree of my case, because this freedom of speech to some extent, despite the fact that I'm a U.S. citizen as well, made me leave the United States of America, because I'm literally getting sick and tired of the American higher education, of this pandering to quote-unquote minorities, of passing grades to my former students, minority students in the United States back in the 90s, just to make sure to keep the house in order and not to rock the boat. So basically, I certainly would like to say a few words. I don't know how much time we got, Deanna, but I hope we are going to tackle a little bit the issue of this academic self-censorship and academic cowardice, which to some extent, or to a large extent, actually landed also Ernst Zindel in prison. But I guess, again, Zindel really sticks out as a glaring example of our cowardly, if I can put it properly, it's a strong word, of our self-censored, self-inquisitorial West and the so-called freedom of speech. So I'm still staying with some general remarks, and then afterwards I'll get down to specifics as far as the German Penal Code is concerned. And I would like to point out to some legal discrepancies in contrast to the German Constitution. I'll just give you a short background. There is no such thing as the German Constitution. The German Constitution goes by the name of Basic Law. And actually, it's not the Constitution. It was actually framed in 1947. Just a short background. And it was not framed, it was not written by German lawyers. It was written basically by American lawyers with a little help of some Frankfurt School friends from the United States of America. So it was a big deal, but folks often forget that in the United States of America, because I must tell you, I attempt to be a little bit elitistic, but if they want to dabble, if they want to deal with the German plight, with the tragedy of what happened actually to the German civilian population after the Second World War, they have to speak fluently, and they have to think also the German language fluently. So I guess I was probably privileged, and I was lucky, and call it luck, it was bad luck, that early on it was the first language I had to learn at home back in communist Yugoslavia. So anyway, 1947, this basic law was framed and drafted by the occupying powers, Germany. Each constitution, be it the U.S. Constitution or the French Constitution, it sounds very good, disarming, right? But I would suggest you folks first read the criminal code. If you want to measure the degree of freedom in one country, read the criminal code. Thanks to my dad, I learned that very early on, because he landed twice in prison. My dad was a Catholic guy, not a fascist, not a Nazi. He was just a normal conservative guy who actually was not politically correct in communist Yugoslavia. So it was just a different modality, but the same purpose actually landed him in prison, like Zindel's, you know. So I can give you many, many of those cases, and we'll certainly talk about that. So anyway, why I'm telling you that, folks, and because if you read carefully the German Criminal Code, keep that in mind, particularly the paragraph 130, it goes by the name popular incitement. This is the rough translation. And I got to look at this a little bit carefully with you, because this is something that creates a great deal of misunderstanding. The German word is Volksverhetzung. I don't want to go now into linguistics, but I certainly would encourage, especially American lawyers, if they want to study the plight, what would happen actually to Ernst Zindel, to be a little bit familiar with the German semantic distortions, if I can put it that way. This actually, the criminal code, if you want to translate it into the basic English, it's virtually impossible. It has so many verbal neologisms, it has so many acrobatics in it, that it really disarms you. I don't know how to translate Volksverhetzung. It goes by popular incitement or popular hectoring of somebody. But basically, if you mention, even to a guy, Joe Sixpack in Munich, in Frankfurt next door, if you tell him about Volksverhetzung, he'll freak out, literally. So I don't want to. Every person from out of 60 million Germans, everybody knows very well what Volksverhetzung means, from the criminal code, from the penal code, if you wish, 130. This is the paragraph 130. And then there are four sections, 1, 2, 3, 4, which explicitly, or rather, yes, explicitly tell you that you are not supposed to denigrate the victims of fascism or national socialism. There is also a paragraph, and I don't know it, I don't have it here in front of myself. There is a word, a sentence that goes that you are not supposed to denigrate people of different religions and so on. But the whole thing is, it is so abstract. So if you have some basics in linguistics, you got to be very, very careful. And I'm sure, folks, those of you who are completely apolitical, even if you don't deal with the Zindel, you will realize that basically the German criminal code, well, I don't want to say it's baloney because it may sound too bad, but actually it's more than that. It just doesn't make very much sense. And it's not compatible with the German constitution, which actually gives you everything, which gives you the freedom of speech, which, of course, we saw in the case of Ernst Zindel. This was not the case. So to my knowledge, and I know the whole story very well, Zindel is not a violent man. He's very peaceful. He's not an aggressive man. He likes the art. He's a good painter. But basically those legal issues, not just from the German criminal code, but also from the Canadian criminal code, which is very surreal to start with, and which I don't quite understand either, although I deal with that because it's in my field. It's my line of work, because it's part of my destiny as well.